Hello, everybody. I'm Kathy Fay, Executive Director of the Boston Early Music Festival, or BEMF, and I'm so pleased to be joined by all five members of our directorial team for this very special pre-opera talk prior to the encore performances of La Serva Padrona and Livietta e Tracollo by Giovanni Battista Pergolesi. Joining me on this internet stage are BEMF co-artistic directors Paul Odette and Stephen Stubbs, opera director Gilbert Blain, orchestra director Robert Mealy, and dance director Melinda Sullivan. Welcome all. Before we begin, as a reminder to those in attendance, this evening's archival video premiere beginning at 8 p.m. can be viewed at any time between tonight and Sunday, July 11th. In fact, for an entire month, as is the case with all of our June 2021 festival performances. If you have not yet purchased a ticket to this performance, you may do so at any time between now and early July at bemf.org. A noteworthy consequence of our virtual festival is that we don't have to worry about running out of festival tickets or selling out of the best seats in the house. The internet stage offers us infinite tickets from now through Sunday, July 11th, and every seat in the house is superb. Thankfully, back in November of 2014, when we first presented this double bill by Pergolesi for our traditional Thanksgiving weekend performances in Boston's glorious Jordan Hall at New England Conservatory of Music, we captured our performances on video, as we do with all of our fully staged chamber opera performance, or rather fully staged opera performances and chamber opera performances. But our archival videos were intended and are intended for our own enlightenment and education, especially when it comes to revivals or recording projects or touring projects. That forethought has certainly paid off. We are so lucky to be able to enjoy these performances again, thanks to the wonders of modern technology, and in particular to our gifted videographer, Kathy Whitman of Ball Square Films, and our audio engineer, Frank Cunningham. Paul and Steve, I thought I'd start with you. In Gilbert's fascinating program notes, he explains how these comic operas started as intermezzi between the three acts of other operas during what we think of today as intermission. Can you tell us more about what an intermezzo is and when and why they were performed?
Well, there were intermezzi already in 17th century Italian operas. Even thoroughly comic operas had comic intermezzi in between the acts. So there was a long tradition of this in the 17th century, but it really took off in earnest in the 18th century, when a group of librettists decided that the classical 17th century style of Italian opera, which was a tragicomedy, which had, in addition to the tragic noble figures of the opera, comic fools, comic servants, as we know so well from Shakespearean tragedies. And these librettists, in the end of the 17th century, decided they couldn't have such riffraff in the middle of a tragedy, and they had to clean things up a lot. And so they declared that operas should either be entirely serious, opera seria, or entirely comic, opera buffa. And it didn't take audiences very long to pine for the color and entertainment value and humor of the comic characters. So the audiences did not respond to these changes at all. And of course, the audience members were the ticket buying public. So this was very important for the impresarios who were presenting the operas. So rather than reverting to the old system that the librettists had railed against, with having comic characters in the plot of a tragic opera, they came up with a new idea, which was to present comic short operas of mostly two acts, sometimes three acts, that they called intermezzi, that were completely separate from the plot of the opere serie that they were performed in between the acts of. So in the case of these two Pergolesi comic Intermezzi, which, by the way, are two of more than 100 surviving intermezzi from this period. There are many outstanding examples. La Serva Padrona was originally performed in 1733 in between the acts of Pergolesi's opera seria, Il Prigioniero Superbo. That was such a hit that 1 year later, in between the acts of his opera seria, Adriano in Syria, in 1734, he wrote a new intermezzo of two acts called Livietta e Tracollo. These intermezzi became such a hit with audiences that they were often performed independently from the opera, the tragedies that they were performed in between the acts. And it in fact became at a certain point more common to hear them performed as separate entities, as we're doing in this production, than to hear them actually performed in between the acts of a tragedy.
I would just add that the whole subject of the comic intermezzo here has a very specific location, which is Naples. And this Neapolitan form became international and was admired internationally. And so Serva Padrona in particular was transported to Paris and became an absolute hit there and sort of began a big controversy about the advantages of Italian opera over French opera. And the other thing that's interesting about the form is that it's almost universally a bass and a soprano, just simply two characters. Sometimes there are others, but that's the classic form. And it's usually, like it is in Serva Padrona, the bass is sort of the master of the house. These are more or less stock characters from Commedia dell'arte, right? This is the laughable bass patron of the very clever servant girl who can think circles around him. And so that format became the classic format.
Thanks, Steve and Paul. Gilbert, each of these intermezzi, as Paul points out, were initially conceived as a companion piece to a large opera seria, but their subsequent performances were presented all over Europe. Both operas were performed in many different versions and under a variety of titles, and sometimes incorporated other music by Pergolesi or his contemporaries. The custom of mixing various pre-existing musical and poetic material to create a work was by then a widespread performance practice, and the term pastiche was used to describe this format. Can you tell us more about why you preferred this format for staging these two comic operas as you did, and in particular, mixing and mingling them together as distinct from presenting them simply one after the other?
Yes, well, the word pastiche is a French cognate of the Italian noun pasticcio, which was originally a pastry filled with a mixture of different ingredients. And this analogy with cooking is very inspiring, in fact, when you built a show like we did. The word itself of pasticcio, to name a musical drama that contains a composition of several authors, come from several pre-existing work of the single author, appears in the 18th century. And by then, the commercial exploitation of the favorite music of the audience, of the favorite performer of the audience, has already become a trend. So these pieces were often assembled in a work which was billed as new. And that's a clear benefit, of course, at the time for the producer to avoid having to compensate composer, who were most of the time unaware that their music has been reused in this manner. A new title was also more likely to sell a greater number of seats, of course. So the creation of a pasticcio for us from a different work, in this case of the same composer, Pergolesi, seem a good way, a good alternative to present a form or an experience of the form, more likely, which was comparable to the experience of the form when these intermezzi were created, which means they are not supposed to be performed originally in a continuous sequence, but be interrupted by another. So marrying the two intermezzi of Pergolesi, Serva Padrona, and Livietta and Tracollo together was also an opportunity for us to find a shape which could be appearing at the period, but also give the audience of today the more experience of approach and distance with one subject of the story to go to another subject and another story. And that's why we alternate and we make our own pie, our own pasticcio pastry by mixing the two pieces, although each scene of each intermezzi is played in extenso. They just switch when theatrically it's possible to alternate the two stories.
Knowing your love for pastries and desserts, you must have just had a blast coming up with all of this information. Robert, we know that Pergolesi managed to create so much music in his incredibly short career, born in 1710 and died a mere 26 years later in 1736. In your excellent program notes, you explain that this remarkable output was thanks in large part to the training he received in Neapolitan conservatories, where young boys were quickly made into fluent composers and performers. Can you tell us a little bit more about Pergolesi's background and how the Naples conservatory methods allowed him to write so fluently and so well?
That's a really interesting question. It's the scene in Naples is such a special one. I mean, all over Italy, there was a huge problem, especially in the early 18th century, of street kids who were poor kids who needed support, who had been abandoned, who had been victims of plague or war, where they've lost their families. And Naples's answer to that was to set up these various conservatories. There were four of them at this point, where students were taught various skills, but one of the big ones was that they would learn to be musicians, because there's a huge demand for, you know, in the churches, you would need singers, you would need players as well. The really fascinating thing about the Neapolitan conservatory system is that it was an incredibly efficient way of teaching people to write really great music really quickly. And this has actually been something that has been rediscovered only in the last 10 years. It's really come to life again, thanks to several scholars who realized that all these, what looked like just baselines, actually turned out to be an entire system of education. They're called partimenti, and they're a sort of shorthand for how to put together something very, very quickly that can be a much larger form. I recommend a really fabulous book called Child Composers in the Old Conservatories by a scholar named Robert Gerdigan, which is a wonderful, wonderful, very, very user-friendly introduction to this whole scene. The cool thing about it is that you too can start performing and composing very quickly with the system. It's a very usable system. And the result of this is a music that was really revolutionary at the time. I think that's one of the very cool things about Pergolesi's language is that everyone thought this was a blast of fresh air. This was something totally new. And it got known very quickly by the term galant, which for us kind of it means a little bit like cool. It's this word that can mean everything and nothing at the same time, but it definitely has all these connotations of lightness, of quickness, of humor. And the really hallmark of it in the music is a super simple bass line and a really gorgeous melodic thread going on. But the comic rhythm of the music is crucial to being able to produce these amazing pieces that are so bound up in the commedia tradition, as Steve said.
We're going to come back to that point in a minute with Gilbert and Melinda. Back to Paul and Steve, there seem to be many serious lovers of Baroque music who admire the music of Bach and Handel, for example, but discount Pergolesi's music as simplistic or superficial or even bland. Can you explain that? Are they right? And if they are, why did you decide to present this double bill?
Well, as Robert was saying, this is part of a Neapolitan revolution. Pergolesi's music, very representative of that new wave. And I have always seen it not just as gallant, as Robert said, but as basically as the gateway to classical music out of the Baroque. And so you could say that those systems were competing at the same time. The system of traditional Baroque music, maybe in our minds represented supremely by Bach. We think of Bach as a kind of musical Einstein. It's so brainy and it's full of really incredible counterpoint. That's not what Pergolesi is. As Robert described it, it's about soaring lyricism and decorative lyricism above from the violin and the voice over a basically very easy to understand, easy to comprehend harmonic system. And I think one of the things about this, not only is it the gateway to all of classical music, but it also, it got its DNA into all of South American music. I've just been doing a lot of South American music recently, and Pergolesi's fingerprints are all over it. You don't feel a whiff of Bach or Handel there. It's all Pergolesi. And I think there's a reason for that. It's so easy to love if you're inclined to just let yourself go and love it without having to think, but this isn't complicated. This isn't
Well, and I think Mozart would not have happened had it not been for the Neapolitan school, because Pergolesi and Jomelli in particular were his musical idols. And he said that he learned most of his musical ideas from them. I think one of the problems with performances of Pergolesi until relatively recently is that they've been frankly rather dreary. They're performed like kind of pre-Mozart in a deadly serious way, sometimes with comedy in the acting, but not comedy in the music making. And what is critical is to look at the original sources and to see how serious they were about enormous contrasts in dynamics, enormous contrasts in timbre, and contrasts in tempo from one moment to the next. And so you really have to enter into the spirit of the story and see where in the music it has to suddenly go twice as fast or half as fast, where it has to go subito pianissimo. The sources are full of little descriptions in the recitatives that this passage should be performed laughingly, and this one sobbingly, and this in a weeping manner, and this in a sighing, and this in a swooning manner. And you realize that they were just going as far as they possibly could with making all of these extreme characters as vivid as possible.
Fascinating. Gilbert, and then Melinda. The libretti offers an abundance of slapstick opportunities, both for singers and actors, thanks to the notably repeated disguises by different characters. Gilbert, can you tell us how you integrated this theatrical element into your staging?
Well, to answer your question, which is very important indeed to understand what the piece are, I have to go back to what Paul just explained about the theatricality, in a way, of the music, the emotional and comical element which can be brought forward by the right type of performance. In the libretti of this intermezzi, there is characters which are mute. There were some reason for that. Obviously, they didn't want to pay too many singers for an intermezzi. So most of these intermezzi have two characters, like it has been said before. But there is other characters there which are really in the story. They have names, they have action, and the story can't develop without their presence. So when we prepared the project with Melinda, we look at these characters and we thought, oh my God, these performers must have been also very skilled as mime, because obviously you can't speak, you need to express everything only by gesture in the pure tradition of Commedia dell'arte, which was very visual and full of slapstick and physical comedy and timing, which is bringing us back to the music, of course. And so we said, oh, that would be a great thing if we put as much energy and interest in these characters, which are most of the time in any type of performance forgotten or dismissed or given to someone who was just passing by the rehearsal room. So we decide with Melinda to say, okay, the main ones we will give to dancers. who have the experience of the physical expression, really by obviously training, passion, and culture, but also to find the right performers who can be funny. Not every dancer can be funny, let's be honest. It's the same for singers. And so Melinda proposed to work with some dancers of a company, and she should explain that to us, because that was really the main action we did on these very important characters.
Yes, it was important to find imaginative performers. I think for all of us, not just for the dancers, but for the orchestra and the singers. Because the slapstick actions are not written out in the score. We had to come up with them. It's an improvisation to come up with them. There isn't even a how-to manual written in the 16th century about how to do commedia, because it was passed on, and some skills were kept secret. It was passed on to family members who then carried on the tradition. So we don't have how-to manuals, but we do have descriptions and scenarios. So we started with that, but the performers really needed to self-compose, create their own part, which is very empowering and super scary too. But we had super performers for that. And especially the two dancers who played Vespone and Fulvia, you can use their full body to express any emotion, to play. So we had to play, and that was our practice, and that was our research. The practice is the research for improvisation. So we needed to find people who could freely do that, which we did, and we had such fun.
Absolutely. Caroline Copeland and Carlos Fitante are stellar in this production. And you have to see that to find all these materials that Melinda was speaking about, of course, a lot of research and reading, but also a very intensive time in rehearsal for all of us. I mean, I'm not speaking only about the dancers, but obviously our fantastic singers and our musical team. It was one of the shows the most intense to rehearse, because there was always something to clarify, to precise, I often say in my bad English, and to make the timing right, so Paul, Steve, and Robert could really do the tempi they wanted and all the color they wanted to give, because the show was always keeping on with the same energy. There were no slowing down or no hesitation in the actor's part, which was allow the music to really really flourish and give the right color that we believe Pergolesi was after.
I think it might be interesting to note that there's a real distinction here between the composed music of the arias and the recitative, which is obviously there as a sort of skeleton to allow the singers to speak as if they were really commedia dell'arte characters. And if you've ever experienced Italian commedia dell'arte, sometimes the words are coming tumbling out faster than you can imagine. Sometimes, as Paul said, they take time to make effects like weeping or laughing or this or that. But what it boils down to is that the timing and the feeling of in the recitatives is entirely up to the talents of the protagonists, of the singers. And so we encouraged them to go for it, even if it was difficult to accompany, because we wanted it to have that kind of spontaneity. And of course, we had superb singing actors to do that.
Absolutely. Robert. Back to our discussion of intermezzi, we know that every city in Europe had a different solution as to how to put on the incredibly expensive art form of opera. In Venice, a network of public theaters grew up in the 17th century, but in Rome, opera tended to be performed in private theaters of aristocracy. What's the story in Naples? Can you tell us more a bit about who came to these intermezzi and where were they done?
Funny thing about opera in Naples is that since Naples was a kingdom, the whole opera season was entirely based around royal occasions. So birthdays, name days, anniversaries. So for example, a Adriano in Sila was done in 1734 for the name day of the king in October. I think the opera houses are enormous for one thing. They had a huge public that came to them, but there are also a number of opera houses scattered around Naples. We were there just 2 years ago, and it was fascinating to actually try to track down the footprints of where these were. And some of them are really like San Bartolomeo, which was where a lot of the first intermezzi were done. They're pretty small actually. So we have a sense that for a lot of, especially the intermezzos, there was a sense that you were really right there with the characters. It was much more like spoken theater in that way. And the crossover between spoken theater and opera, as we've been talking about, I think it was super, super close at this point.
And there's at least some evidence that the orchestral forces for the intermezzi were significantly reduced from the orchestras in the opera seria acts, that it makes sense. You allow most of the orchestra to go on their break during the intermission while the principals go and perform an intermezzo. And maybe they even switched for the people who performed the second act of the intermezzo. So the people who had performed the first act of the intermezzo in between acts one and two of the main opera could have a break in between acts two and three.
Having spent a certain amount of time in the bar at the Naples Theater, I can attest that that still happens today.
I don't want to know about that. This is really a question for all of you, but jump in as you wish. BEMF is known for its discoveries of unknown masterpieces. Why did you take on a production as well known as La Serva Padrona? And related to that, its companion piece, Livietta, Tracollo, is much less well known. I'm curious to know what led you to think about that piece as well and pairing these two together.
I think this was Gilbert's idea. Gilbert, would you like to talk about?
Well, I of course, we all know La Serva Padrona for the reason that as Steve reminded us, it has a huge importance in the evolution of music in Europe in different ways. Obviously, we know the situation in France with La Querelle des Bouffons, but this piece has other major influence in other country, of course. Livietta et Tracollo is not as known. I think it's mostly because the libretto is in fact a little more dated in a way than La Serva Padrona. It's less universal, let's call it this way. That's one reason. But I remember I've seen a performance of Serva Padrona many times in many different staging. It's often a piece which is modernized very heavily nowadays because obviously the conflict of sex is obviously not yet resolved. So people enjoy to bring this story to the disguise of today. When Livietta and Tracollo, you can't really do that because there is so many reference to the period in cultural popular culture that it's difficult. When you see Livietta and Tracollo, you see also, you understand more certain aspects which are in Serva Padrona, which if you look at Serva Padrona by itself, you may not pay attention to this aspect because they are obliterated by the main plot of Serva Padrona, a young woman wanted to marry a boss. When Livietta and Tracollo has many more aspects, but these two pieces communicate each other and enrich each other, not only because you see the variety of inspiration of Pergolesi, as Robert reminded us, 1 year after Serva Padrona, he is writing, I mean, at least creating Livietta and Tracollo. It's a very different type of music in a way. There is many other form of inspiration. So you have a broader way broader opportunity to appreciate the ingenuity of Pergolesi. And at the same time, you can see also that the two libretto, which were made by different poets, different librettists, enrich each other and give them a little more depth in a way, as it would be for a much longer piece.
I think that's right, that Serva Padrona is really the classical intermezzo. It's perfect in almost every way. The balance is so well calculated by Pergolesi. But one year later, when he wrote Livietta e Tracollo, it's as if he wanted to push the boundaries. It's much more experimental, bursting out of some of the conventions that he had used up until that time. It's a much zanier piece. And I think that the brilliance of Gilbert's interlacing the two means that you go back and forth between these two worlds rather than what inevitably would happen if you were to perform all of Serva Padrona and then all of Livietta e Tracollo. All of the audience members would talk about which one was better. Which I always think is a stupid conversation to have about things. Here you have the whole experience of the evening's entertainment.
The other thing that to answer your question, Kathy, why did we do Serva Padrona, which is such a well-known piece? It was sort of the logical gateway for us as a team to enter this world of the comic intermezzo through the most famous example of it. And as we've been talking about, then going on to a less famous example, and we're continuing that process in this fall. In fact, we're going on with an intermezzo by Hasse, the German composer who was in Naples at the same time as Pergolesi and writing these sort of comic operas, and another one by Telemann, a more famous one called Pimpinone. But this means for us that we now have a ticket into this world, you could say, and it's a fascinating world to inhabit. There's going to be some special challenges to the Hasse, because it requires the soprano to speak in all sorts of different dialects and also do a mad scene, and we've entrusted Amanda Forsyth with that role again, which I'm sure she'll do brilliantly. The other thing that I wanted to comment on, because Melinda touched on it, was the idea of this commedia dell'arte art being passed on in families and so on. It was not only that it was kept amongst families, but that people developed a particular commedia character and they stuck with it. I mean, they did that character their whole life, and you could just go from one place to another doing that character. It's similar with, I was reading about the situation that Hasse had in Naples. He developed a relationship with a particular bass and soprano and wrote for them new pieces year after year, the same comic couple, you could say, and they honed their skills. And it's kind of like having famous actors who are famous for a particular thing being in movies over and over again, doing more or less the same thing. It's just sort of fascinating to know about that back then.
You mean half of Hollywood actors?
Yes.
Yes, at least half of them. Yes. Yes.
No. Well, there's so much more to talk about, and we'll have that opportunity after the performance in our Q&A. But just one last question, really, again to Paul and Steve and Robert and Gilbert, who will be with us in Bremen, in Germany, in January of 2022, when we take on a recording of this double bill for our label CPO, where we've made all of our Grammy-nominated and Grammy-winning recordings. I guess I'm curious to know, having performed this now a few times, twice in Boston and three times in a revival at the June 2017 festival and out in Great Barrington at the Mahewi Performing Arts Center, what merits come to the surface of performing it so many times before you're in the recording studio and put the microphone on?
I think having performed the works on stage, you have the dramatic context of understanding exactly what's happening in every moment. For years, decades, people have tried to record dramatic works that they've never done in staged performances, and you can study the score and you can rehearse and you can do all the preparation you want to, but if they say a picture is worth 1,000 words, it's the same thing. The experience of performing theatrical music on stage, you have an immediate visceral understanding of what you have to do at any given moment. So I think these are not works I would want to record without having done them on the stage. I think that would be a disaster.
Well, no disasters.
I just add to that that living with it for a while, as Steve said, we're really part of, we start to have an entree into this world, and we really start to become ever more fluent in it. And as an ongoing company, as a collection of colleagues who've worked together so long by now, it's really fantastic to be able to really read each other's musical minds at high speed, which is the cool thing about this, that comedy happens fast. And that's very, very, very cool to be a part of.
Well, all of you, following our performance tonight at 9:30, please join me along with the rest of you and our audience for a live Q&A on Zoom and YouTube. I know we'll have many more questions about the performances, and I know I'm gonna be especially curious to know what it feels like for Paul and Steve and Robert to have experienced the show from the standpoint of the audience. You've been on stage throughout, as has Gilbert and Melinda, without letting out any surprises. So thank you for this very illuminating talk. And as always, I feel much more prepared to enjoy what I know all of us will agree is a wonderful treat. See you on the other side. Thanks.
Thank you,
Kathy.